Okay, I'm going to start. Okay, so we're going to start. Start here. Okay, so today we begin the first of two classes to think about the institutional corruption inside of our quote unquote or so called democracy. And today our focus is to understand exactly why one might think this current regime is institutionally corrupt. And next class, we'll think about the consequences of that kind of corruption. But to set this up, I want to think a little bit about the framework within which our democracy is formed. There's something incredibly magical in the history of government with the first three words of our Constitution. And the magic is that ours is literally the first constitution in the history of human society, which draws its authority from the direct will of the people. Indeed, here in Massachusetts, it was the first time in the history of human society that a constitution was ratified by the votes of people operating in convention. And this constitution, too, is unique in the history of human society because it says our validity hangs on the people. Now, the people enter the Constitution in two different ways. One way they enter is they are the sovereignty behind which they stand behind the government itself, or upon which the government is dependent. The whole Constitution is dependent upon the people as the sovereigns. But in addition to the people entering the Constitution as the sovereign, Federalist 52 explains that the people enter the Constitution in their role to affect Congress. So Federalist 52 tells us there would be a branch of the federal government which ought to be dependent on the people alone. So in addition to the government as a whole, or the Constitution as a whole being dependent on the people, now we have Congress also dependent on the people. But we have to be careful when we say that, at least at the time of the founding, because at the time of the founding, what they meant was not Congress as in the Senate and the House. They meant Congress as in the House of Representatives. Why was that? How was the Senate selected? Right, state legislatures selected the two senators. So the Senate, you're describing in the ratification debates, the Senate. The state Senate intended as representation of the sovereignties of the states. They ought to be dependent upon the sovereignties of the states. So to say we would have a branch that we'd be dependent on the people alone is to say we would have a House of Representatives that would be dependent on the people alone. The Senate would be dependent on the states. The judiciary would be dependent on the law. The president would be dependent upon the people indirectly, because he, according to the Constitution, it's he. We'll see whether there'll ever be a she, but there it is. The Constitution says he. He gets chosen by an electoral college, the electoral college itself constituted indirectly by reference to the size of states. So the dependencies inside of the government are different, but the dependency of the legislative, the House of Representatives, is to be dependent on the people alone. Now that raises, in constitutional theory, this might not interest any of you, or maybe all of you are going to law school, I don't know, but here it is, your free constitutional theory lesson for the day, raises a really difficult question of what we call synthesis in interpreting the Constitution. Because, as you know, the Senate is no longer chosen by state legislatures. As you know, it is chosen directly by the people, because the 17th Amendment made it so the people choose the Senate in direct elections. So the synthetic interpretive question is, should we now think that not just the House of Representatives ought to be dependent on the people alone, but the Senate ought to be dependent on the people alone? Does that value of dependency on the people alone now transmit to the Senate? Is that the best way to interpret the Constitution? we're just going to assume it does, so that we can just talk about the legislative branch intended to be dependent on the people alone. Okay, that's point one. Second point is, who are the people? What does it mean to say the people? So, for example, would the people have meant men and women both, at least originally? And the answer to that question is no. There was only one state between 1790 and 1807, weirdly New Jersey. I don't know why that would be true, but one state, New Jersey, which extended the right of suffrage to women. Then in 1807, they were kind of beaten up by the rest of the states, and they withdrew the right of suffrage to women. So no state gave women the right to vote. In the middle of the 19th century, you could have the Supreme Court write something like this: man is or should be woman's protector and defender, the natural and proper timidity and delicacy of which belongs to the female sex, evidently unfits it for many of the occupations of civil life. Dominant view is that though they're, you know, important to society, women, they're not relevant to the political process, deemed to be too, quote, emotional. That was the view also of a past CIA director about a certain United States senator in her this last week, called her views about the torture investigations too emotional. Not necessarily related, but there it is, this emotional quality disqualified women. And it was only 1920 women were explicitly by the 19th Amendment given the right to vote. So by the people, the framers did not mean the men and women equally, but equally obvious, today we do mean the people to extend to men and women equally. So today it's both who we conceive of as within the frame of we the people, even if it wasn't both that we conceived of as being within the frame of we the people originally. Okay, so here again, changed attitudes and constitutional rules modify the way in which the Constitution gets applied because of the modification of democratic politics. Okay, so second question. Did the people include black and white people originally? Well, obviously the answer there too is no. We were born a slave nation. And of course we fought this thing called the Civil War. What was the reason we went to war? Or what was the reason the Civil War was begun? You heard of the Civil War, right? Anybody? Yes, secession. Who said that? Yes. It was about union. It was about union. It was not about slavery. It was about union. I mean, slavery and the fight over slavery had brought about the effort by South Carolina to secede, but Lincoln went to war for the purpose of preserving the Union and explicitly contemplated things like the original 13th Amendment, the original proposed 13th Amendment, forbid the government from abolishing slavery forever. The original 13th Amendment was going to be a permanent entrenchment of slavery. But Lincoln was willing to entertain that because the objective of the war was to preserve the Union. But through the course of the war, Lincoln executed the classic bait and switch so that by the time of Gettysburg, he could stand and tell the world that the purpose of this war was to test whether a nation dedicated to a proposition could survive. What was the proposition? That all men were created equal. That was an idea which, of course, though uttered in the Declaration of Independence, had a radically different meaning by the time he uttered it here, because when he uttered it here, it was referring to blacks and whites, even though in the Declaration of Independence, Jefferson, slaveholder, certainly wasn't thinking blacks in the way that this issue was now framed here. So now the war became a war in part about assuring some certain kind of equality. The 13th Amendment, of course, abolished slavery. The 14th Amendment declared the equal protection of the laws. And then, amazingly, the 15th Amendment explicitly forbids states from denying the right to vote on the basis of anybody's race, color, or previous condition of servitude. Okay, now you guys are not lawyers, but that language is pretty clear, right? You can understand that. You can understand that. Can't deny somebody the right to vote on the basis of their race, color, previous condition of servitude. And the framers of the 15th Amendment, who amazingly in 1870, like nobody in 1860 would have bet any money on the idea that America would pass an amendment saying blacks had the right to vote in 1860. Nobody would have thought that. But by 1870, they achieve it. It's an amazing success. And they achieve it, you know, the truth is the history is a little bit ambiguous about the legality of achieving it, right? So the states were basically told they can only enter into the Union if they pass the 14th Amendment. They're basically troops around certain state legislatures saying, okay, you can come back once you vote the right way. So they feel a little bit coerced by this, and there's a whole bunch of pressure in the 15th Amendment as well, but they achieve it. And the objective of achieving it was to create in their minds a picture of something like this: African Americans participating in the process of voting. Or let's be precise, black male Americans participating in the process of selecting their government. That was their vision in 1870. But the reality, of course, was quite different between 1870 and 1960. The reality was not the reality of equal citizenship. Instead, we had a concerted effort to exclude, through a wide range of devices, literacy tests, registration requirements, poll tax, grandfather clauses, and then, anybody from Texas? You're from Texas? Students from Texas? Texas always does things in a grand way. Texas, in the boldest possible way, asserted the creation of the all-white primary. By law, Texas law said, African Americans are not permitted to vote in the Democratic primary. Not permitted to vote. So as explicitly as they could put it, African Americans are not going to vote. Now just think to yourself, I just showed you the 15th Amendment. How is it possible that you can say African Americans are not allowed to vote in a primary? What was their thinking? How do they justify that? Yeah. Exactly right. What they said was, well, no, no, nobody denies that African Americans have the right to vote in the election, but this is a primary. Primary is not an election. Now, of course, in the South, in Texas, you never get elected unless you get through the Democratic primary, because there's one, it's a one-party state. The South is a one-party region. They're only Democrats. I mean, there's some Republicans, but it's more like a joke, right? But they're only Democrats, and those Democrats control the government, and there's no way to get elected unless you get approval of the Democratic primary. But still the claim was the primary wasn't part of the election. It was a private affair. A bunch of people just getting together, exercising their own preferences, and if anything is protected in our tradition, it's the right to associate, so people are allowed to get together and associate however they want, and this is just a bunch of Democrats getting together and associating and choosing their candidate on the basis of what they think and excluding African Americans from that party, just like anybody believes they're allowed to exclude anybody from their own house party. That was the justification. That was the rationalization. Okay. All of these techniques were techniques designed to keep blacks out from exercising the franchise. Okay, the franchise, right? Franchise is a very important term here to keep in the context of American history. The franchise, as OED describes it, it's a special privilege or an exclusive right to perform some public function. It's a franchise because you're using it to perform the public function of selecting a government. Blacks had been enfranchised to a franchise here to make them or set free with investment with a franchise or a privilege. So blacks had in principle been enfranchised, but the Old South found a way to disenfranchise them. The Old South basically disenfranchised them and then created what we could say is two elections every election cycle. There's a general election where everybody got to vote regardless of your race. And there was a white primary. In the general election, all citizens vote. In the white primary, only white Democrats get to vote. And the dynamic, the relationship between these two events is to what you must win in the white primary to be able to run in the general election. So that's a picture of democracy in the Old South. And so what can we say about that democracy? We can say, number one, like the Supreme Court said in Citizens United, the people, all the people, whites and blacks, have the ultimate influence over elected officials, because after all, there is a general election. But blacks in particular have an influence over the elected officials only after the whites exclusively had their way in choosing who are the candidates who get to run in that general election. So it's ultimate influence, but don't confuse ultimate influence with equal influence or equal significance, because obviously whites have much more significant influence in that process. Okay. And number two, obviously to us, the system is a denial of a basic dignity, you could say the equal dignity of citizenship. Equal dignity of citizenship. To say that you are excluded on the basis of your race is to insult the equality of your citizenship. Indeed, in this really fantastic book describing one of the most extraordinary events in the history of America, which practically nobody ever talks about, the massacre in Memphis, this massacre after the Civil War of African Americans in Memphis, describes this African American, he quotes this African American at a state constitutional convention. African American describing what the objective of the war in his mind was. He says, "We want the rights guaranteed by the infinite architect. For these rights we labor, for them we will die. We have gained one, the uniform is its badge. We want two more boxes besides the cartridge box, the ballot box and the jury box." So here's the conception. The minimal elements of being a citizen, the right to defend the nation, the right to choose the government, and the right to participate in a jury. Blacks, of course, had fought in the Civil War on the side of the Union. The South had also tried to recruit them, a little bit harder, but okay. But they fought on the side of the Union. 15th Amendment was to give them the right to the ballot box. The Supreme Court eventually recognized their right to the jury box. But these are the elements, the essential elements. You are not a citizen unless you can do this. And their claim is that denial of either of these two denies them this status of equal citizenship. Now, what is astonishing from our perspective is how difficult it was to remedy this injustice. First time the Supreme Court addresses it is in 1927. That means that's 57 years after the 15th Amendment. The Supreme Court finally gets around to addressing it. The Supreme Court says, an explicit ban on African Americans voting violates the 15th Amendment. Doesn't talk about the, I'm sorry, violates the 14th Amendment. Doesn't talk about the 15th Amendment. So that's not permitted. So Texas goes back to the drawing board. And they pass a new statute. And the new statute doesn't as directly ban African Americans. It delegates the ability to ban African Americans to a state party committee. And in the next case that comes up, Nixon versus Condon, 5 years later, the court says, nope, it's too transparent. It's too obvious. This is basically the state black banning African Americans from voting, even though you've delegated to these state parties. So they go back to the drawing board again. And then in 1935, in this case, Grovey v. Townsend, Supreme Court looks at Texas's latest effort to ban blacks from voting in the primary and says, it's okay. Unanimously, the Supreme Court unanimously says, it's okay. Now, just try to put yourself in the position of being an African American in 1935, picking up the Supreme Court, you know, opinion that unanimously says there's nothing wrong with a system that effectively guarantees no blacks can participate in the selection of governments in the South. Unanimously, you know, it's not a bunch of, exclusively a bunch of conservative crazies. It's a court filled with all sorts of people, many of whom become liberal heroes in the later part of the Supreme Court history of the New Deal. But the court unanimously says that this is beyond the concern of the federal government, and this procedure for excluding blacks from voting in primaries is permittable because it's private associations, it's not public power. Okay, that's 1935. 1941, though, there's an important innovation that leads to the undermining of this doctrine. And the case is a case, U.S. v. Classic. Now, the issue in U.S. v. Classic has nothing to do with the all-white primary. The issue in United States versus Classic is, in Louisiana, there was an election where blacks were able to vote, but the people counting the ballots said, sure, you can vote, we're just going to tear up your ballots. So they tore up the black ballots and didn't count them. And there's a law that bans people from mucking about with voting systems. So they were prosecuted under that law by the U.S. attorney. And they challenged that law by saying the government has no authority to regulate what we do in a primary, because a primary is not an election. Of course, you can do it in an election, but you can't do it in the primary. So trying to block us from excluding black ballots in the primaries is unconstitutional. It's beyond the scope of the federal government's power. And the courts disagrees. Very important. I'm going to spend a little bit of time on this, but here's a very important way in which the court disagrees. He says, but we are now concerned with the question whether the right to choose at a primary election, a candidate for election as representative, is embraced by the rights to choose representatives secured by Article 1, Section 2. That's the constitutional provision that sets out the right of the people to choose their representatives. They say, we may assume that the framers of the Constitution in adopting that section did not have specifically in mind the selection and elimination of candidates for Congress by the direct primary any more than they contemplated the application of the Commerce Clause to interstate telephone, telegraph, and wireless communication, which are concededly within it. So they're saying the framers didn't think about primaries, just like they didn't think about telephones or the internet. But that doesn't mean we just don't think about how the Constitution applies to these. The court says, we read its words, the words of the Constitution, not as we read legislative codes, which are subject to continuous revision with changing course of events, but as the revelation of the great purposes which were intended to be achieved by the Constitution as a continuing instrument of government. The great purposes. And the great purpose here is to empower the people alone to choose their representatives. That's the great purpose. So here they say we have a change in the mode of choice from a single step, a general election, to two steps, the first of which is the primary. So it used to be we had one step, now we have two steps. But there's no historical warrant for supposing that the framers were under the illusion that the method of affecting the choice of electors would never change, or that if it did, the change was for that reason to be permitted to defeat the right of the people to choose representatives for Congress, which the Constitution had guaranteed. So the court's saying there's no historical warrant, meaning the mere fact that the way in which we choose electors or choose representatives changes doesn't mean you ignore the constitutional principles as they apply to that change. So the change also has to be tested by the same great principles that you would have evaluated the original system. And so just like you would say excluding blacks from choosing in the real election, the general election, violates the Constitution, now if you separate it out and have a primary as well as a general election, the same principles have to apply. That's the historical warrant. So the primary was protected by the Constitution against public and private interference both. And so the primary now becomes as important a event to guarantee constitutional principles apply to as the general election, so that 3 years later, in this case, Smith versus Allwright, 1944, the court reverses Grove v. and declares the all-white primary as unconstitutional. And it takes a long time, not immediately, but eventually the same kind of principle is extended to all the other devices throughout the South, so that by the middle of the 1960s and the Civil Rights, the Voting Rights Act, there's a presumptive equal right to vote gets to be taken for granted within our system. All right, that's a long history, but here's the key that I want you to focus on. We had a system of an election to choose representative, and then we had elections to choose representatives. We went from a step one, chooses representatives to a two-step project, step one, step two. So elections, not one election. These elections were public, meaning the public was entitled to participate equally. The public, the rich and poor, male and female, older and younger, and eventually, after 70 years, finally, we would say black and white. Everyone gets to participate equally within the selection of that of representatives, even though it's a different process from the one the framers envisioned. And that's key to thinking about how we interpret the constitutional protection. US v. Classic's point was change was expected. The way in which you elect representatives would change over time with technology. But fidelity in the context of interpreting the Constitution means preserving the framing values in light of that change. So you want to say the framers had a certain set of values? Whatever the changes are, we want to preserve those values in light of those changes. You could say we want to translate those values into the current context so as to preserve them against the burden of whatever has changed. The framing values in this current context. All right. To negate any effect from the change. Framing values. All right, let's go back then to thinking about where the people are. I said male and female were not originally within the framing values. Now they are both thought to be protected by the people. Black and white were not originally within the context of the framing values, but now both are conceived to be within the scope of what the people are. What about rich and poor originally? Did the framers intend the people to embrace rich and poor both? And here, what's kind of stunning, did you want to answer that? You think no. How many people think no? I think that's got to be the normal view. Right. The answer is yes. The answer is yes. We've been polluted by this kind of bad Beardian history about what they were trying to do. No. They are pretty explicit about their ideal that the people embraces rich and poor both. Indeed, Madison, shortly after telling us we were going to have a house dependent on the people alone, in Federalist 57 says, by the people he means not the rich more than the poor. Not the rich more than the poor. And at the time they are framing the Constitution, there are people saying things like, look, the rich people ought to have more power in this democracy. They have more resources. They're likely to be more intelligent. So the rich ought to have more power. And the framers considered that and rejected it, explicitly rejected it. Luther Martin here describing the, in the debates of leading up to the ratification of the Constitution. Hence it was urged the inequality of representation, or giving one man more votes than another on account of his wealth, was altogether inconsistent with the principles of liberty. Or again, in same debate context, that to those who insist that he who pays the greatest share of taxes ought to have the greatest number of votes, it is a sufficient answer to say that this rule would be destructive of the liberty of others and would render them slaves to the more rich and wealthy. What's astonishing, given that we don't remember this at all, is that the framers are the original anti-aristocrats in the sense that they desperately wanted to craft a republic that would not build a permanent aristocracy or a permanent division between the power of the rich and the power of the poor. Now you say, well, wait a minute. One thing you certainly learned about, I certainly hope you learned about, is that at the framing, to have the right to vote, you had to be white, you had to be male, and you had to own property. And it sounds like, well, if you're giving the right to vote only to people who have property, that doesn't sound like an anti-aristocratic idea. It sounds like an aristocratic idea. But there are two reasons why we misinterpret what that property requirement was about. Number one, we forget that the framing society was much more egalitarian than ours. Probably 90% of white males satisfied the property requirement. 90% had, quote, property sufficient to qualify to vote. But number two, the purpose of the property requirement. I think this is a bullshit purpose. I don't think it's actually true. I don't mean it's bullshit in the sense that they don't believe it, but they really do believe it. It's not true, but this is what they believe. The purpose of the property requirement is to protect against aristocracy. So how does that work? This is Blackstone's interpretation. The true reason of requiring any qualification with regard to property in voters is to exclude such persons as are to be in so meaning poor, a situation that they are esteemed to have no will of their own. If these persons had votes, they would be tempted to dispose of them under some undue influence or other. This would give a great, an artful, or wealthy man a larger share in elections than is consistent with general liberty. So the concern is people without property would become dependent on the rich people. The rich people would buy their votes and say, vote with the way I want you to vote in exchange for this money. And so you would expand the power of the rich people because they could be buying these votes. But if you had property, you would be independent. You couldn't be corrupted like that. So you'd be independently voting on the basis of what you think is good for the public. So it's more likely in that context that you would act in the interest of the public as a whole as opposed to what might personally benefit you. Yeah.
What if you were on the poorer end of the property spectrum, though, so like you were willing to give up your vote for someone else? Because would that not counteract what they were saying about?
Yeah. So this is not a proof that nobody would be willing to sell their votes. It's just suggesting that the most likely people interested in selling their votes would be disabled from selling their votes, who wouldn't have the vote. And the important thing to remember is, in fact, for most of the 19th century, vote buying was the most reliable way in which winners got their election. And the reason vote buying was so common is that you voted in public. People basically got together and raised their hand. I'm going to vote for Madison. I'm going to vote for Johnson, right? Now, in that context, it's easy to sell your vote. Because you walk in, you say, I'll sell my vote to Madison. And the person who buys Madison's vote comes in and watches and sees you put your hand up and says, OK, fine, you voted for Madison. I'm going to pay you $5. And it's only when we created anonymous voting that vote buying disappears. Because once you have anonymous voting, it's not like you couldn't sell your vote. You could say, yeah, no, give me $5. I'm going to vote for Madison. But you could be saying the same thing to somebody else, too. So the value of the contract is radically reduced once you anonymize the voting process, because you have no way to verify that, in fact, the person voted like that. So if you look at voter participation rates through the 19th century, they're sky high. And then once they bring in the anonymous voting, they fall off dramatically, because a whole bunch of people are like, why waste my time voting now? I'm not getting paid for it. I'm not getting beer for it, or whatever. So I'm not saying that this prediction of exactly how things would work was actually true. All I'm trying to say is, if you're interpreting what they were trying to do, you can't say they were trying to create an aristocracy because they created a voting requirement. It doesn't follow. In fact, I think their motive was to the contrary. But that reinforces and coheres with the claim that what they're really trying to do is to create a system where the rich and the poor both were included within the scope of what we think of as the people. Now, the punchline about this part is to say, look, if we think of all the values the framers had, there are a bunch of them were really awful, right? They were slave owners, for God's sake, really awful. We should not hesitate to criticize parts of our framing past. But there are parts of the framing past that are really wonderful. The idea of founding a constitution on the basis of the public's acclamation of it, it's amazing. And the idea of creating a government dependent on the people alone, rich and poor, both, is amazing. But what's bizarre is that if there's any framing value that we ought to be preserving today, if there's one we should be picking out and saying, this is the one, let's celebrate this one, it would be this one, the equality idea, equality of participation in citizenship, this idea of equal rich and poor for the purpose of voting. I'm not saying this means that we have to equalize wealth. It's just equal participation in the context of selecting the government. But we don't. We don't. We reject their segregation between white and black. We reject the disempowerment of women. And we've rejected their embrace of the idea of protecting rich and poor both. We've rejected all three of these framing ideals. And the real manifestation of this, I think, begins around 1994, when the system of elections begins to radically change. As we radically increase the amount of time members spend engaging in fundraising, Now, we've talked about this briefly before. I gave you a statistic that said members spend anywhere between 30 and 70% of their time raising money to get back to Congress to get their party back into power. But the more general thing to recognize is that the whole congressional system moves to this world of the perpetual campaign. Meaning there is no time when candidates are not campaigning in the sense of raising money, at least, to fund their campaigns. And perpetual campaigns are bad. How do we know that? Barack tells us. He says we can't have perpetual campaigns. He tells us that on his way to a fundraiser. On his way to a fundraiser, he tells us we can't have perpetual campaigns. It's a really awful thing. And he's right about that. It is a really awful thing. But the change here should lead us to ask these two very different questions. First, what does it do to us as citizens as we move from the system of equal representation to this system of fundraising, both in the sense of us in the representative democracy, which is the element of the, is a necessary condition of being what the framers would have called a republic. Well, I want you to think about that against this background that I've spent a lot of time sort of setting up, the Old South, right? If this was the picture of democracy in the Old South, a white primary and a general election, and we understand why that was a denial of the basic elements of what a democracy should be about, we need to recognize that the United States has recreated a system of two elections once again. Once again, we have two elections. So right now, these two elections look something like this. We have a discrete election where you kind of show up and you vote, and you have a continuous election that happens 24/7 between one election and the other. The discrete election is the voting election. The continuous election we could call the green primary. The continuous election is the process by which candidates try to get you to give them money. They want you to give them money. And they do that 24/7 between one election and another. They're constantly saying to you, please send me money so I can run my campaign. That's an election too. That's an election too. But it's a very different kind of election, right? Because in the voting election, constitutionally, all citizens are allowed to vote if you're over 18, some states if you have an ID. But in the green primary, the relevant voters are the funders of elections. The funders, the people who give enough money to matter. To matter. And the structure of this is very familiar, given the background of the white primary. To run in the general election, in the voting election, you've got to do extremely well in the green primary. You don't necessarily have to win. There are people like Jerry Brown who spend much less money, people like Meg Whitman who spend a ton of money and lose. But on average, you must do extremely well. Just like in the white primary, to be able to run in the general election, you had to do extremely well in the white primary. Not necessarily had to win. Some people, or one or two cases of somebody entering in the Republican primary, blah, 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 but in general, that's the way it had to happen. So this has the same structure as this. The green primary and the white primary are structurally similar. And since they're structurally similar, we can say the same things about the green primary that we said about the white primary. So we can say Supreme Court and Citizens United was completely correct. People do have the ultimate influence over elected officials, all of us, rich and poor alike. But only after the funders had their way with the candidates who wished to run in that voting election, because in order to be able to run in that voting election, you have to make the funders happy. And number two, I think we should say, obviously, even though this is not yet obvious to our Supreme Court, there's a certain denial of dignity or equal dignity of citizenship that we have created an election system where we exclude a significant portion of us from having the equal role in the first of a two-stage election. Okay, that's what it does to us. Then we can think about what it does to them, members of Congress. And here again, we've talked a little bit about this. The thing to do is to focus on what life dialing for dollars produces. Like if you spend 30 to 70% of your time as a member of Congress calling people to raise money, what does it do to you? I give the image of the B.F. Skinner box, suggesting we begin to understand the life as a congressman against this model as they slowly intuit, they learn through intuition which buttons they need to push in order to raise the money they need from the funders to get the resources they need to get elected. And after they do this for 2 or 3 years, they get pretty good at it, and they don't even necessarily know what they're doing that makes them so effective at it, but you can be confident what they're doing is signaling to the funders their willingness to return the benefit to the funders. So it's not that you got to keep separate. There's more to this, though, than just the amount of time. It's not the problem of just how much time they spend raising money. The critical point is from whom they are raising this money. Because it is the tiniest fraction of the 1%, really, really tiny. There it is. Look how tiny that is. It is 0.05% of America who are the relevant funders of campaigns. 0.05%. Last time I went through these numbers, I gave you the statistics. 0.26% give $200 or more. 0.05% give $2,500 or more. 0.01%, the 1% of the 1%, gave $10,000 or more. 0.00042%, 132 Americans gave 60% of the super PAC money that was spent in 2012. Tiny, tiny number of Americans who are serving as these funders. And that tiny, tiny number has this incredibly important role in the first of these two elections that define the way American elections work. So 0.05% is about 150,000 Americans. The internet tells me that's the same as the number of people who are named Lester in the United States. Are there any Lesters in the room? Other than me, I'm a Lester. Okay, this is why I call the United States Lesterland in my TED talk, right? We understand we live in Lesterland because we live in a place where a population as small as the number of people named Lester have the power to determine the first of these two elections, the Green primary. And so Lesters call the shots in the Green primary, and the Green primary is an essential step on the way to the general election. Now, I'm sure you heard, you can see why this is a problem. The problem has these two elements: the amount of time that they're spending fundraising and the slice of America from which they are fundraising. And again, if we think of it against the background of the Old South, the one virtue the Old South had, however heinous it was that blacks were excluded from the Democratic primary, the one thing the South could say in defense is whites were a majority. Whites were a majority. But in the Green primary, the people who exercise the power in the Green primary are the tiniest, tiniest fraction of a minority. The vast majority of us are excluded. Right? So if you think about the dynamic and recognize how tiny a number of people have this powerful role, you begin to recognize the way in which we've undermined the basic objective of creating a government which is dependent on the people alone, because an incredibly important part of the people, all except the tiniest, tiniest fraction of the 1%, don't have a role in this critical election. Now, I'm sure you heard about this case that was decided earlier in the month. Usually the court hands down cases Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. They skipped April 1st, April Fool's Day, and they handed this down on April 2nd because been a little bit too embarrassing to hand this down on April 1st. This is the McCutcheon case. This was the case where the Supreme Court struck down aggregate contribution limits. So what they said is you can be limited about how much money you can give to any particular candidate. So you're only allowed to give up to $5,200 to any particular candidate. But the question here is, could you be limited in the total amount you give to all the candidates you want to give to? So, you know, if you wanted to give $5,200 to every candidate, the limit said you couldn't. That was way above the limit. So the question the court had to address is, do these aggregate limits survive constitutional review under the First Amendment? The Supreme Court said no. Aggregate limits are eliminated. So now instead of giving a total amount of about $126,000 every 2 years, which is what the limit was, to candidates and parties and PACs. Now Americans are free to give up to $3.6 million every 2 years. $3.6 million every 2 years. It was that when I was at this TED conference this last time, I was in an event where a whole bunch of the people there were people who give the maximum amount, and they were talking about the McCutcheon decision. They were terrified because they said the one thing about the aggregate limits is they gave them an excuse. And the Democratic Party called them up and said, you need to give more. They said, no, the law says I can only give $126,000. Now the law says $3.6 million, which is the amount they would be giving if they give the maximum amount to every candidate on their side of the aisle. So $3.6 million. Now, what we know about the dynamic of fundraising is that if you remove the limits, you change the business model of fundraising. So if you're raising money and the limits go away, you're going to spend your time raising more from a smaller number of people. So if you ask what are the relevant number of funders, and you say today it's about 150,000, my view is that number is going to fall dramatically. Let's say it falls to 35,000, which the internet tells us is the same number of people as people named Sheldon. So the point is, we either live in Lesterland or we're going to live in Sheldon City, but this is a dramatically different dynamic for a democracy from one which envisioned dependence on the people alone. And I think plainly violates the framing value of that equality by impacting this two-step democracy where most of us don't have a relevant voice in the first step. Okay, that's what it does to them. Okay, now, in this last part, we have basically about a half an hour to talk about this last part. I want you to articulate, because I've been doing a lot of articulating, but here, now your chance to articulate. You don't need to have slides. You can just articulate with your voice. How we think about this as a problem. Like, why is it a problem? All right, so the first thing is, you might say, for consequentialist reasons, it's a problem. So what might the consequentialist reasons be that a system like this creates a problem? Well, let's start with, what were the consequentialist reasons that the white primary was a problem for African Americans in America, in the South?
Because it perpetuated all sorts of racist laws and institutions.
Right. It had the consequence of disfavoring them in the legislative process, which meant all the structures which were maintained for the purpose of preserving inequality were supported, and blacks didn't have sufficient political power to do anything about it. So if you think about politics as about what do you get from the government? The consequentialist problem with Lesterland or Sheldon City is that if you're neither Sheldon or Lester, your government is not going to be giving you the things that you want it to give you at the proportion in which you would be entitled to them if, in fact, you had a democracy that was dependent on the people alone. So these consequentialist arguments are the sorts we're going to or the consequences, the actual ways to map out what actually happens because of the way in which we fund elections, the things we're going to talk about Thursday. We're going to think about the way the agenda gets changed, the way in which what Congress actually passes gets changed, and ultimately, fundamental to our conception of institutional corruption, we're going to think about the way in which it undermines or affects the trust people have in their democracy to deliver to them the things that a democracy is supposed to deliver. So one idea is the problems of the consequences. But a second set of problems you could just think of as the normative problem to Lesterland or Sheldon City. What is normatively the problem with Lesterland or Sheldon City? And this is what ties directly to what I described as the dignity argument about what citizenship means. Lesterland and Sheldon City deny equal dignity to citizens in participating in the electoral process. Right? And the way in which you can imagine this being articulated is somebody could say, African-American in Texas in 1922. In what sense is this system equal if they get to call the first election? If they get to call the first election. Where they there means whites. How is this an equal system if whites get to decide the first election? Or in Lester, Land, and Sheldon City, the statement would be, if you're not Lester or Sheldon, you would say, in what sense is this an equal government if they, the Lesters or the Sheldons, get to call the first election? Boss Tweed used to say, I don't care who does the electin', as long as I get to do the nominatin'. That's the instantiation of the two-stage election process where somebody has power over the first stage, and people who don't in that first stage have a legitimate claim. This is unequal. But what I want you to think about is how far that idea goes or doesn't go. Okay, so let's say you lived in Texas today. You're from Texas? Right. Do the Democrats still have the power they once had in Texas?
No.
So Texas is a Republican state. So if you don't win the Republican primary, you're not going to be likely to be elected as a governor of Texas or senator of Texas. All right. So Democrats could say, in what sense is this equal if they, the Republicans, get to call the first election? That first critical election determines who ultimately gets elected. Would you say it's a violation of equality that the Democrats are relatively disempowered in Texas because the Republicans have so much power? Is that the same kind of denial of equality that, let's start with just the white primary is? It's the majority, and what also is distinct about this? Yeah.
It's also based on ideology rather than something you don't control.
Yeah, you choose, right? A lot of things we have arguments about whether you choose or not, but I think you do choose. You get to choose whether to be a Democrat or a Republican, right? It's not like an ambiguity. You just decide that. You might feel like you're compelled to be a Democrat or compelled to be a Republican, so it's not really choice, and if you think that, maybe you do think there's an equality problem here. But if it is a choice, you can just say to the person, it's simple, you don't like this, become a Republican. Become a Republican. You can vote in the Republican primary. All you gotta do is change your registration. So even if you're excluded, you're not excluded on the basis of something over which you have no control. Right? What about a 12-year-old? Are there any Germans here? Like real Germans? Like people who are German? Now, in Germany, there's a 12. How old are you, son?
Almost 12,
perfect. Do you think it's an unfair system that we exclude you, deny you the right to participate in these elections?
Yeah.
Yeah, of course you do. And why? Why do you think that? Because what gives you the right to vote? What entitles you to the power to vote here? You're human, and what we're doing is making your future really bad, really bad. Because basically everything the United States government is doing now is about making the next generation's life terrible so we can live it up. We can live it up, right? So we're gonna live it up, we're gonna have like Social Security. I'm gonna have Social Security, you, no Social Security for you. It will not be possible, right? So you legitimately have a claim, which is why can't I exert my choice about these policies that will affect me? And in Germany, people like, what is your name?
James.
James. People like James are a political movement. There is a fight in Germany about lowering the voting age. I don't think it's to 12, I think it's 14. So you have two more years if you want to be German, but to lower the voting age on the argument of this precisely. But how many people, I mean, you know, don't look, James, because I don't want people to be embarrassed about this, but how many people really take seriously James's claim? Really? You're persuasive, sir. Because the average American, which of course you guys are not, but the average American would totally reject James's argument. The average American would say, it's ridiculous. Child thinks he has the right to vote. ridiculous, just like in 1910 saying, it's ridiculous a woman thinks she has the right to vote. Or in 1860, it's ridiculous an African American thinks he has the right to vote. Right? What I mean by that is we collectively have this prejudice that we take for granted, none of us. You're gonna be a kind of either 12 or a crazy person to think 12-year-olds have the right to vote. But I'm with you, I'm a crazy person, so I'm with you. But I also think dolphins should have the right to vote, so I'm like totally inclusive. But you all sort of, the ordinary American, the ordinary person will draw these lines and they will be unproblematic. They will seem to you unproblematic, and the thing you need to recognize is that's exactly what it felt like to those who thought women should not vote in 1900, or those who thought blacks should not vote in 1850, right? They were wrong. They were wrong. But you guys are wrong. Certainly, you are wrong. Like, your kids will think you are as wrong about something, might be James's issue, I don't know what it'll be, but your kids will think you're just as wrong about whatever that issue is as you think your parents were wrong about gay rights or maybe about, you know, if you come from a part of the country, racism, whatever. You pick the issue that you look at your parents or your grandparents and think, how could they possibly think that? Your kids are going to say that about you. Right, that's just the nature of the way social ideals change. And so there will be a they that to our kids or your kids will seem like a claim of justice that for us does not seem like a claim of justice. It seems like a claim of crazy people. Do you have your hand up? I think it's completely rational for people to say there's no reason to participate. But it's wrong to say, therefore I'm going to do nothing. What you need to do is then say we need to change it so that it's rational for you to participate. And it's not, you know, if you think about, this is what always strikes me about this issue. You know, our parents and our grandparents in the 20th century took on some really tough problems. Fascism in Europe, racism in the 1950s, 1960s, 1970s, sexism in the 60s, 70s, 80s, homophobia, 70s, 80s, 90s. These are really important, difficult problems. And you know, you don't solve them like that. You don't kind of wake up one day and you're no longer a racist. It takes generations to rip that out of the DNA of a society. It takes hard work. But this problem, I'm going to talk about what the solutions to it looks like next time, but this problem could be solved overnight. Like, there is no one in Congress today who, if they change the system so they are not spending all their time talking to the Lesters or the Sheldons alone, would say, oh, I remember the good old days, the good old days, when, you know, the values of our republic, where we only were worried about what the tiniest fraction of the 1% cared about, were, in, you know, part of who we were. Nobody would want that. I mean, you know, we would just change the incentives, it would change the system, the world would be radically different. So this isn't a social problem in the sense of we have to change people's minds. It's an economic problem. We just have to change the economic incentives for giving money so that more of us are giving money, just like more of us are voting. So I get your desire not to vote. I don't think it justifies you not doing anything. Okay, more, yeah. Wait, I just couldn't hear the first part of it. So are we becoming more exclusive or inclusive?
So I guess the first question is, like, so do you believe that there's actually a trend towards becoming more inclusive?
Yes.
Or is that, okay. And then I guess, why do you think that is?
Yeah, so, you know, so society improves in lots of ways. So we become more, this is contrary to your expectations, but it turns out we are radically more peace-oriented today, less violent than we were hundreds of years ago, or even 100 years ago, but certainly thousands of years ago. Like, society becomes more peaceful, and society becomes more inclusive, the more we understand about different people. Like, you start off as these tribes where, you know, the divisions were sharp, even though the people could be exactly the same, they're sharp, he's my tribe, your tribe, we're going to be radically hateful to each other, but over time we improve. That's progress, that's great. We have certain blind spots, it's not like linear, certain blind spots pop up and like later you can't understand them, and I think this inequality one is going to seem like one of those blind spots. Like it'll just seem weird that we had this system. It'll seem weird that five justices of the Supreme Court think it's unproblematic to say that there's no limits on the amount of money you can spend in political campaigns and no limits in the aggregation amount that you can give directly to candidates. It'll just seem weird. But eventually, I think, you know, people will just come around to recognize the way in which that is a core part of what it means to be a citizen. And one way we get there is to distinguish it from a very different claim. Like, there are people out there who are egalitarians all the way down. Right? They want to say equal citizen, equal property, equal lovers. I don't know. You add all the different dimensions that you might say people ought to be equal in, and they're for it all the way down. There's a great note written in the Harvard Law Review about called lookism, like the radical inequality in society produced by attractive people versus non-attractive people and all the things we ought to be doing to fix that, right? So you know, we could have egalitarianism all the way down. I'm not talking about egalitarianism all the way down. I'm talking at its most basic place, citizenship, the ability to participate in crafting your government. You would have thought it was obvious that was a core element of it, that had to be equal if we were a democracy. As opposed to an aristocracy or a plutocracy or something else, you would have thought, but somehow we've come to this weird place where it's a controversial idea, and I think I can't believe it survives. It's controversy. Yep.
So, how do we change the economic incentives of the Supreme?
You come to class next week. I mean, next Thursday. That's how you do it. That's all you have to do. Another question. On Thursday, I will make the argument that if you change the way you fund elections, you would radically change the incentives towards polarization.
Because like, they both act with each other in a sense, and it's like the more polarized it becomes, the less a lot of people will give, and the more concentrated the sole fund, like the smaller group of funders will fund.
Yeah, there are a couple dynamics that are going on here. Number one, there's great work by Demos that demonstrates that large contributors are radically polarized. So if you look at large contributions and relation to political attitudes, it looks like a U function. So the larger you're contributing, the more polarized you are, number one. Number two, polarization excites people to give money. So if you're kind of a milquetoast in the middle, you know, moderate, it's hard to motivate people. But if you're a far right winger or a far left winger and you're talking to your base, this is what excites them. So if you're trying to raise, you know, not the Lester contributions, but the small contributions, it's better to be an extremist. And Chris Murphy, who's the youngest member of the Senate from Connecticut, describes that when they send out emails attacking the Republicans, they raise three times the amount of money that they raise when they praise the Democrats. Right, because people love to respond to anger. They don't love to respond to, see how great we are with them. So yeah, this system of funding, I think, radically puts pressure on polarization. And when we see what the solution is, I'll have the other half of this of why you can see the solution is actually pulling back pressures to polarize. Now, we shouldn't, I don't mean to overstate it. We are a divided nation. You know, a lot of the polarization gets driven by demographics. It's just the case that we are different people and we believe different things. That's fine. That's totally okay. It's not like we need to produce a democracy where we all sing kumbaya right in the middle of the distribution. But we should worry if the way we fund elections exacerbates polarization. Because the one thing we know about polarization is the polarization of the politically active Americans is severe, while the polarization of America is not that severe. So where the polarization manifests itself is politically active souls. And part of that is because, as was suggested before, the non-politically active, normal people, look at the system and say, these are crazies. I'm not going to participate in a system with these crazies. So they stay at home. So in some sense, you're appealing to the crazy, polarized people because you know those are the people who are going to vote and give you money, and so that's what's that helps drive that. Okay, more questions? Yes. Okay, so it follows from that that regardless of how you change the rules, there will be no change in what gets spent. Because if you're saying that it always finds its way in, whatever the contours of the rules are, we should have basically the same amount of money in. Right? But that's just not true. It's just not true that we get the same amount of money in. So if you look at outside spending, this is from 2001 to the Citizens United decision. That's after the Citizens United decision. Right? So if it's the case that money always found its way in, what was that money doing before Citizens United? It didn't find its way in. But now Citizens United opened the floodgates, and it poured right through. So I do believe that on the margin, there are always ways to push back. But I don't believe that what follows from that is the rules don't matter. The rules really do matter. You would radically change the way in which campaigns get funded just with minor changes in the way the rules work. And so we shouldn't give up the search for better rules because, indeed, they have a dramatic effect on outcome. OK, other questions? This is fun, this question time. It's good. Good. You are? Yeah.
You said that the McCutcheon ruling struck down aggregate limits, but then you mentioned that, I think, it's 3.6 million figures. So what is that?
Yeah, so it's hard. It's a little bit. Not intuitive. So it strikes down aggregate limits, but what remains are limits that you can give to individual candidates. So I am still only able to give $5,200 to Elizabeth Warren every election cycle. She runs once every 6 years. Is that true? Am I allowed to give it to her every 2 years? I can give it to her every two. No, only when she's running. Okay, so I can give her $5,200 every 6 years. Because she only runs once every 6 years. Joe Kennedy, I can give $5,200 every 2 years. I don't give money to politicians anymore, so I'm not actually talking about what I'd give, but OK. I did give to Elizabeth Warren, but OK, put it aside. So the point is, one could give $5,200 every 2 years. But what McCutcheon did is it said, you can give $5,200 to everybody. So if you wanted to give $5,200 to every Democrat running in elections in the House, at most that's 435 Democrats. Probably not, because there's some districts where they don't have Democrats running because it's all Republican. But 435 times 5,200 plus 33 members of the Senate who are running, so 5,200 times 33. Plus you're allowed to give a certain amount of money to parties. Plus you're allowed to give a certain amount of money to PACs. So if you add all those things up, the people who have done the calculation say, that means everybody is permitted now to give $3.6 million. Because now you're just constrained by the individual aggregate limits, not constrained by an aggregate limit. Well, I don't know. You guys have seen Blade Runner, right? Haven't seen Blade Runner? It's the most important work of philosophy in the 20th century. You've got to see Blade Runner. I can't help but believe it's progress that continues. Like, the more we understand, the more empathy we can practice, the more we include within the sphere of who's entitled to be treated as one of us. That's not to say you couldn't imagine something happening. You know, the Taliban takes over the world. Okay. Not going to be a lot of progress for a big chunk of time. But I don't think the Taliban is going to take over the world. Right? So I just think that the pressures here are for more understanding, and understanding is the minimal element of what I'm calling progress. Or the Electoral College. So I think the Electoral College, the arguments around the Electoral College are motivated by much more by theoretical, I don't mean merely theoretical, but I mean theoretical concerns versus really practical concerns. Because the reality is the Electoral College doesn't matter that much most of the time. Now, sometimes it really does matter, like, it mattered in 2000. And it certainly matters in the way in which campaigns are conducted. So, you know, there's a move to, without amending the Constitution, basically remove the Electoral College by saying that every state commits to allocating their electoral votes proportionally to the vote of the citizens of the state. If that happens, presidential candidates would run in every state. And right now, every election, you know, if you're in California, you never see a presidential candidate except if they're coming to a fundraiser. If you're in New York, you never see a presidential candidate unless they're coming to a fundraiser. But if you're in Ohio, they basically live in your house. That's all they do. Because Ohio is one of the swing states, and New York and California are not. Utah, never go to, nobody would ever go to Utah. Either side, why waste your time? But if you eliminate the Electoral College, then you could win votes in any state. So now, you would radically change the way in which you campaign. And in principle, I'd be for that, but only once we've solved the funding problem. Because if you radically increase the number of places that you have competitive elections, you increase the cost of elections. If you don't fix the way in which you fund elections, you just exacerbate the problems of the Lesters or the Sheldons. No. The McCutcheon the Citizens United decision benefited the Republican Party more than the Democratic Party, because the amount of aggregate, the amount of that kind of wealth from corporate funding tilts more dramatically in one way or the other. But there's just as many Democrats who will be maxing out to the 3.6 as Republicans will be maxing out to 3.6. They're rich Republicans and rich Democrats. So I don't actually think this is going to benefit one side more than the other. It's just going to change. What it's going to do is it's going to benefit the Lesters and the Sheldons much more than they are benefited right now. Hard to imagine that's possible, but that's what it will do.
I don't mean this question to sound cynical, but
okay. Okay, so my belief is it has a very tangible effect on the relevance of people participating in the democracy. But to make that claim credible, I have to do the work in answer to the question that was asked before about how would you change it. So Thursday, when we work through what the change would look like and how that would ramify through the system, that's where you need to try to evaluate whether this is just theoretical or whether it's actually real. But I think one way to set those expectations up is even if you have equal rights to participate, It doesn't mean you win, right? So you know, in a system that eliminates racial inequality in voting, there still is a radical difference in the numbers on either side that if those motivate votes, produce different outcomes. But in the context of the issue we're talking about, you know, it's not really, I want to make this clear because I should have made this clear in what I was talking about. Though Madison talks about the rich versus the poor, the Lesters don't stand for the rich. The Sheldons don't stand for the rich. They don't represent the rich. What they do is they represent people who would benefit from leveraging their power in the political system. And there are many rich people, I think probably most rich people, who are like, I'm not going to waste my, I don't want to do anything. I don't want to have anything to do with that. Like, I just want to go out and live my life, or I want to run my business. I don't care about benefits from the government. So this is not about the rich as much as it is people who think that there's something they can get from the government, whether tax benefits or lobbying gets them special contracts or protections or all sorts of things like that. So I do think when you think of them like that, you will see the way in which changing the system of election will make tangible citizenship in a way that it's not right now. But I can't, let's just, you can ask that question again at the end of the next class. Okay, one last question. Yes, sir. Yeah, so gerrymandering, invented here in Massachusetts by Governor Gerry in 18-something, early 1820, I think, certainly exacerbates the problem, I think. But I don't think solving the gerrymandering problem is a solution if you don't solve the funding problem. And it's the same argument that I was given about the Electoral College. If you eliminated gerrymandering, you wouldn't get to a case where 100% of seats were up for grabs every election cycle because there's some geographic difference. Like Utah is going to be Utah regardless of gerrymandering. Like there's no doubt that it'll be a conservative Republican state. But you will increase the number of competitive seats from about 15%, maybe to 40%, maybe to 60%, different estimates based on how you think about it. So that means the cost of elections goes up dramatically. If you don't change the way you fund elections, it just exacerbates the problem of the Lesters and the Sheldons. So it's a problem to be solved, but there's a sequence of reform. And I'm talking about what I think the first reform has to be is the money, and then you can start thinking about the other problems like Electoral College and gerrymandering and things like that. Okay, see you Thursday.